Well, thank you for joining us here today. My name is Brad Bell. I'm one of the elders and the founding pastor at the Well Community Church. Welcome to Home Church. We are in a very unique time in our country and in our world, and what we're trying to provide for us today is an opportunity to worship the Lord, to assemble together, if not even virtually, and to hear the Word of God taught. And this week's Home Church is a very unique experience for a number of reasons, not the least of which this is the first Home Church like this we have ever done, but also there's multiple congregations gathering us. So a welcome today to the Well Community Church, who are familiar with myself and my friends that are here in the studio with us today, but also a welcome to our friends at St. Rest Baptist Church, who are joining us also, to Simi Community Church there in Simi Valley, who are in pastoral transition, and they're going to be joining us as well, to our friends at Hume Lake Christian Fellowship. Delighted that you guys up the mountain there are joining us as well. But we know there's going to be all kinds of people from around the country looking for a church opportunity. And so if you are a guest with us, we are so glad you joined us here today. If you, by chance, live in Fresno and would like to get connected, if there is a need in any way in these times, if you go to thewellcommunity.org, there's both opportunities to post needs that you might have, but also places for you to get connected, because though we don't assemble together in one room, we still are the church together, regardless of what neighborhood we are in. So welcome today. Let me pray for us and let's worship a little bit. Father in heaven, I do thank you for who you are. Thank you that in these uncertain times that you are still sovereign and that you are good, and that we can assemble, if even in a unique way, in homes all throughout our community. Lord, would you just be glorified today? As we worship you and as we enjoy time in your word, would you be pleased by the offering that we present? We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Captive free, Lord, I can't help but see. Human heart is native cry.
Jesus. Cause I won't bow to idols, I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, then I'll rejoice cause you're there too. And I won't be formed by feelings, I'll hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Death is just a doorway to resurrection life. And if I'll join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. Will you return in glory with all the angels and the saints? My heart will still be singing, my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified, the altar of my
My name is Brad Bell. I'm one of the elders and the lead pastor here at the Well Community Church. So glad you're joining us again here for Home Church. If you have your Bibles, open to James chapter 1. As you look at the early church and just sort of trace the movement of Christianity in the first century, one of the things you find early on is the early church experienced incredible persecution from those around. And because of that, they ended up getting scattered abroad. And as you read through the New Testament, you get little glimpses of this persecution and what happened because of it. For example, Peter, who seems to be writing in 1 Peter to the believers that were scattered to the west or in modern-day Turkey, writes that Peter, an apostle of Christ, to those who reside as aliens scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Those are all in modern-day Turkey. So he's writing to the believers in the west, but it's James, if you look at James chapter 1, verse 1, who seems to be writing to the believers scattered in the east. It says, James, a bondservant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes who are dispersed abroad, greetings. And most scholars believe that James is writing to Jewish believers who were in Syria and Iraq. And as he's writing to them, these are believers who are dispersed abroad, and it's James who's writing. Now, the question, of course, if you've read your Bible, is which James? Because there's like 1,000 of them. And this happens to be James, the half-brother of Jesus. So he grew up in the home of Jesus and was son of both Mary and Joseph. And what's interesting about this James and his brothers, for that matter, is according to John chapter 7, they don't initially believe in Jesus. John 7:5 tells us that not even his brothers were believing in him. So their faith journey sort of came later as they watched Jesus begin his ministry and begin to sort of show who he really was. But this James later becomes actually one of the leaders of the church. So when you look at Acts 15, it's James who's actually part of the Jerusalem Council, standing up in leadership of it. And you'll notice again in verse 1, he refers to himself as a bondservant. It's a very powerful word. It's a word that means a servant or a slave who has been freed, but based on their care and love and the relationship with the master, chooses to willingly yield himself to the master's authority. And so he refers to himself as a bondservant. And it's James who's now writing to early Christians dispersed abroad, living in difficult times, encouraging them to strive for maturity and holiness in life, regardless of their circumstances. And just by way of context, there was multiple persecutions that these early Christians were experiencing. Some of it, of course, was religious, as a Jewish community rejected these early Christians and a pagan Roman community rejected them as well. But some of it was even just social persecution. The Romans didn't trust them. Neighbors were skeptical because they didn't participate in the religious activities. They were shunned by their communities, and there was even imperial persecution of the Roman government that sort of came and oppressed them and began to actively pursue them. And though sporadic and localized, it was indeed a thing where they were running for their lives, and even oftentimes shunned by their own communities to the point where they couldn't even buy groceries at the local agora or market. All of that sort of setting up this idea that these believers probably didn't have gathering places where they could assemble outside of homes. And so maybe they're enjoying in some ways, although we're enjoying with a little more technology, this idea of doing church in a much, much smaller context. There weren't gathering places in this context for believers to assemble even whatsoever. And so when you look at the book of James, it's by far the most practical book in our New Testament. And what's, I think, fitting for us in this situation is just as James is writing to believers in difficult times, scattered abroad, who aren't able to assemble together, here we are in our culture, scattered abroad, in difficult times, not even able to assemble together ourselves. And I'll be honest with you, in 20 years of ministry, I would have never told you that I would have encouraged you as a faith community to forsake the assembling together. In fact, this idea of doing church in homes, though novel, in some ways pushes on my ecclesiology a little bit because we're called to do life together. And so what I'd like to do, as we are sort of dispersed abroad, is see if we can glean some insights from the book of James. If you look at verses 2 and following of chapter 1, a very familiar passage, "Consider it all joy when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance." This testing, by the way, is the idea of showing that which is genuine. And it produces this testing of your faith, endurance. Some of your Bibles might say patience or even steadfastness. And it says in verse 4, to let this endurance have its perfect result, meaning yield to it, submit to it, so that we may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. What James is saying is these times of difficulty have a purpose. God uses them. He uses them as times of testing, times to affirm the genuineness of our faith. And if, like in this book, we'll submit to these times of testing or difficulty, God uses them to produce something in us and through us. I would call these moments or opportunities growth opportunities. Can you think back in your life to times that you have been through that have been difficult or challenging or pushed you a little bit, yet on the other side of it, you look back and you said, boy, that shaped me. Like, I can think back to times as a young aspiring athlete. I used to wrestle, and I just got pounded most of my wrestling career. And I learned lessons through that, and it was those lessons that actually helped me grow, not just as an athlete, but even as a man, to learn that those times actually made me stronger. I'm raising right now 2 teenage daughters. Do you remember what it was like to be a teenager? Full of all kinds of issues, all kinds of socially awkward moments, moments where you feel like you're on top of the world, and then moments you just want to crawl under your bed and hide. And yet it's those moments, those growth opportunities, that produce something in us. And what James is writing now about are believers that are experiencing incredible growth opportunities. The Apostle Paul, when speaking of these things in Romans 5, said that we exult in our tribulations. We lift up our tribulations, knowing that our tribulations bring perseverance, perseverance proven character, and proven character, he says, ultimately bring hope. And so today we are in the midst of a very interesting growth opportunity where it's testing the genuineness of our faith and the current difficulties of us isolating, socially distancing, even quarantining. The question is, what is God doing in this time? And I would suggest this growth opportunity is producing in us an incredible opportunity to put the gospel on display. And that's ultimately what James is going to challenge now his readers to enter into, is this idea that in these moments of testing and trial, God is doing something. And by the way, If you just quickly look at verse 5, if you've ever looked around in your life during a growth opportunity and just thought, God, what are you doing? Verse 5 is the verse you need. It says, if any of you lacks wisdom, not in general, specifically in context, while experiencing difficulty and trial, if you lack wisdom, not why it's happening, but what God is trying to show you, then he says to pray. And as you pray, God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, it will be given to him. If you lack wisdom in these times, pray. And so here we are praying, saying, God, we're doing church in our homes. What's going on? God, we are being told to socially distance and isolate. When in difficult times, our tendency is to want to come together, we're being told we can't. God, our normal rhythm of life is disrupted. I don't understand. And as we're praying, my prayer for all of us really is that we'll begin to sense what God is doing in this time, what he's producing in us. And here's what we know. We know that God is sovereign. We know that God is not surprised. We know that he is not unaware, that he has a purpose, he has a plan, he's growing us, he's maturing us. And we'll look back on the other side of this growth opportunity and say, man, look what God did in us. Look what God grew through us. And with that in mind, if you look at verse 22, he's going to go on to say, James says, that we need to prove ourselves not simply to be hearers of the word, but what he calls doers of the word. Part of the opportunity we have in this interesting time is to not just talk about what we know about God, but actually live out what we know about God, meaning that we can actually put into practice his words of not simply being forgetful hearers, but what he calls effectual doers who begin to take action in times of crisis like this. And so in this coronavirus growth opportunity, how do we begin to put into practice what the Bible actually says? And I'd like to focus, if we can, actually on chapter 2. So turn in your Bibles to chapter 2. I'd like to look at verses 14 and following. He's making this connection of authentic faith being demonstrated by how we live. And he says, verse 14, what use is it, my brethren, if someone says that they have faith, but they have no works? And then he asks a question that's a really loaded question. He says in verse 14, can that faith save him? Now, can that faith save him is an important question for us to ask, because he's saying, in a sense, can a workless faith, a deedless faith, save? Now, we need to make a quick theological clarification. There is no doubt that the clear teaching of Scripture is that God is the one who saves us through Christ and Christ alone. So Ephesians 2 tells us that it's by grace that we've been saved through faith. It's not as a result of works, so that any of us would boast. Titus 3:5 says that he saved us, not on the basis of deeds that we have done, but by his mercy. And then even Romans 9, verse 16 says it's not man who wills or man who runs, but God who has mercy. So God is the one who makes the first move and saves without our help. So we don't participate in our salvation whatsoever. We're saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. However, that being said, genuine faith, biblically, seems to produce good works. Jesus said in Matthew 7 that you will know them by their fruit, that a good tree cannot produce bad fruit and a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. You will know them by their fruits. And so, for those of us who claim to have genuine faith, there should be a demonstration of that faith in how we live. Now, the caution is, when times of difficulty come, if we are not moved to action, if we're not stirred by compassion, if there's not a sense of something's wrong and I'm compelled to be a part of the solution, we need to make sure that we have not embraced a counterfeit faith. Because what the Bible seems to communicate is that our faith should move us to good deeds. Look at verse 15. He says, look, if your brother or sister is without clothing and in need of daily food, and you say to them, go in peace, be warm and well filled, and yet you don't give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that? He says, even so, faith, if it has no works, is dead or useless, being by itself. What does that mean? It means simply, in times of crisis, religious pleasantries are not helpful. In times of crisis, so God is good all the time and all the time, God is good, is actually not beneficial. To say to somebody, hey, God bless you, or to say to somebody, hey, look, I know it's a crisis right now, but God works all things for the good. Like, I appreciate the bumper sticker, but truthfully, faith without deeds, he says, is dead or useless, meaning that's a good start. And it's not suggesting that any of those statements are in and of themselves false. It simply means they're unhelpful if not matched with deeds. In fact, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 27 says, "Do not withhold good from those to whom it is due when it is in your power to do it." And so this coronavirus growth opportunity has given us an incredible opportunity to actually put the gospel on display. And the reality is, friends, we need to embrace the fact we don't know what we don't know. We have no idea if this is like the flu or similar to. We have no idea if this is going to be over in 2 weeks or 8 weeks or 6 months or 18 months. We're not sure, but here's what we do know. Because God is sovereign over it all, because God is leading us through it as a growth opportunity, he's producing in us a maturity that without this difficulty, we would not have had otherwise. He's also inviting us to demonstrate our faith through our deeds and to actually show up and in some ways have a critical incarnate expression of the gospel in our city. Look at verse 18. He says, "Someone may say to you that you have faith and I have works." And he says, "Show me your faith without works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. But are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow, that faith without works," here it comes again, "is useless or dead or not helpful?" See, there's a sense that as we begin to show up and put the gospel on display, two very profound things happen. One, we encourage other believers. Because you start looking around and you see believers showing generosity and believers showing compassion and believers showing speaking up for injustice and giving a voice to the voiceless. And you go, that is the gospel. I mean, that is who Jesus has called us to be. And there's a sense that we're encouraged by that. Many of you, at least here in Fresno, experienced last week a glimpse of that with Sir Fresno as we tried to serve our community. And there was a sense of like, something about this just feels right. Like that's what God has called us to do. But the second important thing that begins to happen is the non-believing community takes notice as well. See, I'm convinced that the non-believing community is not interested in what our church bulletins look like or even what our music sounds like or even what we're teaching. What they're curious is, show me. So you who are claiming to be followers of Jesus, how is that changing you? And as we begin to put the gospel on display, in growth opportunities like this, it shows them the gospel, it shows them the love of Christ, it shows them biblical compassion, it shows them biblical generosity, it shows them the value that they have as those created already in the image of God. And in that, it puts the gospel on display. See, historically, as times got difficult, whether it was the first century or following, it was actually the Christians who were on the forefront of the movement of compassion, the movement of showing the love of Christ. When there was infanticide that was happening in the Roman world, it was the Christians that came in and adopted. When there was those hungry, poor, sick, or downtrodden, it was the Christians who showed up. When there was those who were vulnerable or powerless, it was the Christian. And so what a growth opportunity we have to be the church and to remind one another that the church is the people, it's not a building. So whether we gather corporately or not, we can still be about it. So whether we assemble together in one room or not, we can still proclaim the gospel and put it on display in our city. And as this passage finishes, it's interesting, James chooses to talk about two biblical examples from the Old Testament that the Jewish Christian audience here now, those who were Jewish and trusted Christ, would have known very, very well. Notice verse 22, he says, "You see that faith was working with his works." Look at verse 24, it says, "You see that a man is justified by works, not by faith alone." You see, it seems like a biblical contradiction, but the "you see" is showing us that this faith that is initiated by God is actually evidenced by, and we see it by, how the good works flow out of our lives. And so he uses Abraham as an example, and then the other in verse 25 is Rahab. And it says, "In the same way," meaning in the same way as Abraham, where you saw, you see. In verse 25, "It was not Rahab the harlot declared righteous or justified by her works when she received the messenger," meaning she authenticated her faith in receiving the messengers, hiding them, and demonstrating her belief in God. All of that summarized in verse 26, For just as the body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without works is dead, lifeless, a shell or a spiritual corpse, if by itself. And so what can we learn from this text? I think there's a couple of things that are just takeaways. One is I think we can trust God, that the character of God, the faithfulness of God over time, that he is good, that he is able, that he is sovereign, he is in control, and therefore he's in control even over this coronavirus. There's no doubt though that even though God is in control, we're in the flesh and there is fear and there is anxiety. And I would encourage you to remember James 1:5, that if you lack wisdom as to what's going on, to pray to God. Don't be surprised, by the way, when you pray for wisdom, that he doesn't answer your why question, but he keeps leaning into the what question. Very seldom when you ask, why are you doing this, God, is he going to give you an answer. But if you say, God, what are you trying to show me? What do you want me to learn? God will speak into that. And by the way, Philippians is another good passage to turn to. In Philippians 4, if you have fear and anxiety, even though God is sovereign, if there is that natural tendency to fear and anxiety, he tells us, Paul does in Philippians 4, to be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, to present our requests to God. So the first thing we can learn is that we can trust God. Second is I think we can learn that this is indeed a growth opportunity, the likes of which we have never seen. Can the church be the church when it doesn't gather? And I'm excited to see the church show up and be about it in a profound way, because when we look at passages like 2 Corinthians 4, where Paul says that momentary light afflictions are producing in us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comprehension, while we look not at the things that are seen but are unseen, for the things that are seen are temporal, the things that are unseen are eternal. God is doing something behind the scenes, and if we as the church can show up, put that gospel on display, actually authenticate our faith by our deeds, I think it's an incredible growth opportunity that God has placed before us to care well for people, even in crisis. And look, I don't intend in any way to make light of the fact that for many, this will be a very difficult time. I simply mean this, that in the difficulty, we can be the hands and feet of Christ. And the third thing is with that, we have a very unique opportunity to demonstrate our faith by our deeds. And I want you to think about this just sort of in three concentric circles. You've got friends and family, you've got neighbors, and you've got your community at large or your city. What does it look like to care for our friends and family, our specific neighbors, and then our city as a whole? And over the coming weeks, we want to give you some tools and resources to help you do just that. And by the way, one of the amazing things that happens in our life when we get our eyes off of ourselves and we start looking at others as opportunities to show them the love of Christ is we start actually living like Jesus, who did not come to be served, but to serve. We start living like Jesus, who Paul said of Christ, he says, do not do anything out of selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourself. Look, I get the hoarding mentality. I tried to go, like many of you, get some toilet paper at the store the other day, and my goodness, it's like empty shelves all the way through. Because in some ways, people are focused on themselves. But if we as the faith community could authenticate our faith in our deeds and begin to look at others as more important than ourselves, people start seeing the gospel afresh. And so can I just encourage you? Look, let's go. Like, let's be about it. Let's grow, let's trust God, let's care well for others, let's put our faith on display, let's be the church. Because in this time of crisis, both believers and unbelievers need to see that the gospel is actually powerful enough to change our lives, change our perspective, and minister to us and through us, even in a time of crisis. Let's pray. Father, I do thank you for your word, even in this unique situation. God, would you be pleased to use this for your glory? Help us to authenticate our faith by our deeds. You have changed us. The gospel has made us new. So as we see the needs in our community, as we see the physical concerns of those around us, as we see those in need, could we be moved to action to go and help, to be the hands and feet of Christ in our communities? And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Before you turn this off, one sort of final admonition. Let's take advantage of the opportunity we have together to embrace the intimacy that when you're gathered in a room of any number of people in a normal church service, you don't tend to have. And I would encourage you to take the opportunity after you turn this message off to take some time to dialogue as a family or with your friends, to pause for a moment, to enjoy communion together as a community in your own home, to simply use this opportunity as a chance to not just worship and hear the word, but even experience the word of God together as a community. So grateful you joined us for Home Church. Be praying for whatever city you are in. Be praying for our country and our world, that God, by His grace, would use this growth opportunity for His glory and our good.